Hey, so good morning, everybody. I'm Sophia, and Anne-Marie Sassen is the head of unit of the unit dealing with the European Digital Innovation Hubs. We are here to make a question and answer session on how to write a proposal. So in case you are new to the platform, I remind you that on the right side, you can click on several icons. The lowest one gives access to some of the documents that we will discuss now. If you go one up, okay, you see the participants. The second one from the top is the question and answer session. So you can write there the questions. I would suggest waiting a couple of minutes before typing the questions because I want to do an initial introduction on how to submit a proposal that can already answer some of the questions. Okay, what we want to show you is this document that you see on the screen. What is it? Is it, let's say, a draft of the template for the application form? If any of you is familiar with submitting a proposal to Horizon 2020, it will not be surprised. I mean, submitting a proposal for a digital innovation hub will be a very similar process. You will have to register on the participant portal. You will enter into the participant portal, write part of your proposal in a structured way, like, you know, the information on the partners, on the participants, the budget, and so on. And then you will have a more textual part where you have to explain what the proposal is about. And here you can see, well, first of all, this is a draft, so this can change, that you will see huge differences, but don't take this as the Bible because, I mean, it is supposed to change. The important, interesting thing is that you will have at the beginning all these administrative forms to be submitted in the portal. Then you will have a project summary where you explain in short 500 words or something like that what your project is about. And then you have to follow the main parts that will be used in the evaluation. So first of all, you have to explain the relevance of your project. Then you have to explain how you want to implement the project in practical terms, the type of activities that you will do, and so on. And third, you will have to explain which impact your work will do. And again, the format will be the same for all Digital Europe project, but with some very specific things for the European Digital Innovation Hubs. Let's start from the relevance. You see, the first sub-criterion is alignment with the objective and activities as described in the work program and in the call for proposal. So, if you are a digital innovation hubs, what kind of information should you put here? You should write what is the focus of your digital innovation hub, which is the region or the sector that you are aiming at, which application area, which technology you want to cover. What are the target groups? Are you looking at SME only? Are you looking at startups, at all the fashioned companies with the need to do the first step in digitalization, and so on? How will you set up and operate a digital innovation hub? So do you have a specific experimentation facility? Do you give access to, I don't know, an high performance computing platform and you can help the companies to use that one? What you will do about this? Which services and competences you can offer and under what conditions? So you know that the overall services that we ask to digital innovation hubs are test before invest, so giving to the companies the possibility to play with the technology before investing in it, reskilling, helping to upgrade the skill of the people, training, finding investments, so moving around all the thousand possibilities that you have to get European and national regional funds and help them to find the right one, all these kind of things. And then you have to define your services, KPI and targets. There are a few things that we ask very explicitly. You will see a table in the form that is this one. You have to describe the services foreseen for the Digital Innovation Hub and explain what is your target. So, service to provide, for example, access to an high-performance computing platform. Number of businesses that you think will use this service. It will be one, it will be 10, it will be 100. Number of public administration. It will be one, zero, or whatever. How many of your customers will come from other regions or other countries? Because if you have a specific competence, you on one side, you will work on your local requirements, local companies, local SME, and so on. On the other side, you will give support to companies coming from other parts of the network. This is the sense of having a European network. So you have to explain this. You have to explain the service that you give. For example, test before invest on additive manufacturing platform. How many business will get from the outside? This is your estimate. Training. We ask similar things. You will plan to have trainings for, learning how to use artificial intelligence in business or starting using a new wonderful technology or simply introducing existing technologies in the normal workflow of the company. You say which courses you think you organize. The organizer name is, the hub or contractor which does courses for his main business. What type of course will be? Will be a remote course, a workshop, a daily course? How long it will last? It will be 1 day, half day, 10 days, 20 days? How many attendees you will have, you plan to have? The price list, this is very important. This is asked for in the work program. For state aid reasons, you need to define a price for each service. So you say, description of the service. What do you have there? Description of the service will be, for example, access to the wonderful facility to test additive manufacturing technology. And they say that for every test that you want to do, you want to build a thing with this 3D printer, I make to the company, the price €5,000. And for which unit of measure? For number of experiments, for example, or for an high-performance computing center could be for CPU time billed and things like that. And then you can offer a reduced price to the SMEs. You can offer zero, for example. You say, okay, for the small companies, I give this service for free. For the large companies, you cannot give it, cannot do it. Or you can say, okay, for the SME, I give a discount of 10%, 50%, or whatever, according to the budget that you have in your hub. Then how your proposal relates to other parts of the Digital Innovation Hubs, of the Digital Europe program. The Digital Europe program has many parts. Don't forget that it is about artificial intelligence, high performance computing, cybersecurity. So, for example, I make a very, very practical example. Cybersecurity is needed more or less everywhere. Suppose that you plan to have a joint collaboration with the cybersecurity center that you mention here, the other European Digital Innovation Hub, and you explain which kind of investment you will do together to help the SMEs in your region or those outside of the region. Again, these are tables that we ask for to understand in detail which kind of services you will give to your users. Contribution to long-term policies of the European Union. So you know that the big policies of European Union now are European Green Deal, national digitization policy, specialization strategies. We have a policy of trying to make Europe strategic, autonomous in strategic technologies. Which of those things are supported by your hub? Is there a collaboration foreseen with other initiatives which are relevant? One could be the Enterprise Europe Network or Startup Europe, or there is the old Idealist, which is the network of NCP active everywhere in Europe. Do you have something like this? Please explain. Explain how you will do it, if you have a formal agreement, an unofficial agreement, if you plan to work together, because consider that things like the Enterprise Europe Network do activities which are very much complementary to the activities of the hubs. Enterprise Europe Network namely works on the growth of small companies, helps them to go to foreign markets, this kind of things. They don't deal directly with digital technologies. You, as Digital Innovation Hub, you deal with digital technology. So you can do things that the Enterprise Europe Network does not do. But please avoid doing the same things twice. Try to find an agreement with actions which are already active in the same area to the same target, so that what we want, as is written somewhere in the work program, is a seamless service. That would mean that I am an SME. I go to the hub says, ah, this is not for me, but look, I call the colleague in the EN network who can help you. This is what we mean by seamless service. Extent, well, this is not applicable. Extent which the proposal can overcome financial obstacles such as the lack of market finance. I said before, a few minutes ago, that the one of the objective of the hubs is helping companies to get the funding that they can get either from European funds or from national funds, from the other all the types of supported of support that they can get. So here we would like to have a target. So you can say here, for example, I plan to help companies to get funding from the European funds for agricultural funds, because my area is the agro-food, and I target an amount of 100,000 euro for my customers that they will get from these European funds. Or in my member state, there is a specific fund for fisheries, for helping fishermen to manage their fleet or make it greener and things like that. And I will use this specific fund to giving access to the companies and helping them to know how to make the request and get the money and so on. And we want a target here. I want 100,000 euro, 1 million euro, 10,000 euro. But I mean, what is your aim for these things? We need to be able to measure. Okay, on the implementation, I will not say much, because implementation is the same for all the Horizon projects. And it's basically, I mean, do you have a good project plan? Do you have a clear resources which are adequate for what you want to do? Are your partners capable of doing the work that they have to do? I assume that in most cases, a hub will be a consortium of participants. That's not a requirement. It could also be a single entity. But I mean, there will be several people who have several different complementary know-how. One will be an expert in funding, another one will be an expert in digital technology, a third one will be an expert in integration, and so on. Do you have the resources to do what you claim to do? Do you have the facilities that you need, and things like that? Let's go to the, well, you have to identify the risk. The third point is the impact, which is also a bit specific for the Digital Innovation Hub. So how well your European Digital Innovation Lab will contribute to achieving a complete network of at European level. So think not on backyard, the companies which are in your region, which you already know and you can reach, but how will you contribute to the entire network? Will you offer things that are useful for people from other countries? Will you offer a specific know-how? Will you be able to do something special that is useful? Dissemination and communication. Which kind of outreach do you plan to have for your Digital Innovation Hub? Do you plan to use social media? I don't know if social media is relevant. Do you plan to use the events organized by the local entrepreneur association? Do you plan to what is your idea on action to reach your target? Then, what are the effect to increase the competitiveness and bring in general positive things for the society? There was a long discussion, was said several times this morning that what we are doing, trying to digitalize European economy, is not a minor task. It's an important task, and the objective is not only to make companies more competitive, is make a world which works better. A world where next time there is a pandemic or a big crisis, companies are so flexible that they can survive and we don't have the unemployment, high unemployment that we are suffering now. Companies where health services are supported by digital technology and can reach out better to the citizens. All these kind of things. So, the target, which are your target groups for the Digital Innovation Hubs? How they will benefit concretely from the project? And what will change for them in terms of digital maturity? Then you can describe here the innovation that you will support, the barrier obstacles that you see. There are many. I think for me, you know, I'm a technician, so the biggest obstacles I see are the administrative ones and the legal ones. So which regulation, standardization, rules and small things to remember, all these things that are a problem, please specify here. Last but not least, whenever possible, please things that we can measure and understand. And I want to make this clear. I mean, it's obvious that when Hub will start, we'll get a grant with the European Commission, and then we'll be measured. There will be a review every year checking to understand what has been done and what should have been done. Don't consider this as you know, a tricky thing or something that is meant to punish digital innovation hubs. The real objective of asking you to define indicators is that if we cannot measure something, we don't know what is happening. We need to be able to measure as much as possible the impact that this network of European Digital Innovation Hubs will have on the companies, on the economy. And the better numbers we have, the better we will be able to steer in the future the intervention and to make in such a way that the impact is high. So please get it right. I mean, it's very important to get numbers. It's not because the European Commission wants to control everything of you. Okay, it's partially true because, of course, you will get public money and we have to check that they are reasonably used. But I can guarantee that nobody will tell you, you said that you would have done you know, a course for 500 people and you did for 400. No, this is not good. The objective is to measure what was needed and what is the requirement coming from the field, from the board for for your case. Well, last but not least, the Green Deal is the main policy of the Union now. I mean, it's clear that cannot survive if it's not sustainable. So do you do something specific for environmental sustainability? It's not mandatory. I mean, you can do also things which have nothing to do with environmental sustainability. But if you do, please describe here. This is it. There is only one last thing that I want to show you. Then here you will have to explain a lot of things which are more or less standard in all package, the deliverables, the timetable, and so on, things that allow us to understand if there is a good plan behind the idea that you want to do. There is one annex that is specific for the Digital Innovation Hub, that is this one. It's the letter of designation of a member state. So a European Digital Innovation Hub, as you will be 50% funded by your member state. You have been pre-selected by your member state, designated, as it said. And we want here to have a proof of this designation that can be the email you received, the link to a government website, or any valid document with information on changes to the proposals. Why? Because the designation has been done early and something can change. I make a very simple example. I'm Italian. In Italy, where designated a high number of hubs was designated. Too many, we cannot fund them. So we proposed to the hubs, okay, try to merge, try to get together so that we have lower number. We will not have to you know, send away most of you because there is no money available. So if something like this happens, if hubs, hey, and apps B merge together, we need to know here. We ask you to explain, okay, what we did is we took part of the activities which was originally proposed for this and that, and we added that. Or in many cases, when you do the pre-selection, when you do the designation process in member state, you don't have all the partners. You have a general idea, you have the main coordinator, the basic idea of what you want to do, but you don't know who will support a specific technology, or we will reach out to the companies and you still have to find them. So you will have added partners. And here we want to know this. It's just to clarify, for us to understand what has changed between the designation process and the evaluation of the European call, also for transparency towards member states. That's all. Okay. It's over. I spoke really a very long time. Now, I don't know, Anne-Marie, were you able to follow the question and answer? Can we answer something?
Yes, certainly, Sandro. I can follow the questions very well. I just want to make a remark to our technical support, Marine, maybe. The people in the live preview could not see very well the document that Sandro...
Now it's...
It's changed? Okay. Okay. That's good then. So the most popular question is from Heini Wallander. In the application template, we should already give a very detailed plan of the services. How to tackle continuous development of the services and new topics and needs from the SMEs in, for example, trainings. So this, Heini, is a correct observation of you, and we also fully understand that there will be a continuous evolution. Nevertheless, we would like that in your proposal, you already state what you plan to do now. And then, during the course of the project, there can be amendments. We don't need amendments for small things, but if there would be big changes, there could be an amendment. But it would be normal that while you are working, your services are, there is an evolution. Some of the services are maybe not so interesting for the SMEs, whereas others turn out to be very important and a lot of demand for that. So this is indeed a dynamic situation. Nevertheless, the experts need to choose between all of you. And for that purpose, they need to have an idea on what you have in mind. And that is what you write in the proposal. I think this also answers the question of Patrick, who says that the EDIHs are not static. So we totally agree. They are not static. You cannot predict now exactly how everything will happen. But based on your experience, you can make a proposal that describes how you see it now, what you are planning to do. And that is what you should do. And then there is, when you have the grant, there is the reality, everyday work, you will learn, you will understand what would work better. And those changes, of course, you can make. And if there is a change of participants, for instance, then we would need, of course, an amendment to the contract. And that is certainly possible. You can also change the price list. The price list is really used for state aid purposes to monitor how much value every SME that you've helped is getting over a period of 3 years' time, and to check whether that support remains below the 200,000 euro border. I want to say that state aid is something very complicated. We have a session during the workshop where this is explained better by DG Competition. So if you have questions around that, I would like to invite you to join that session. And after that, there will also be a specific session with questions on state aid.
The question on maturity, maybe I can help here. Maturity is a bit difficult to define. And if you look at the document, it says only explain the current level of maturity of the proposed action. That is the state of preparation of the readiness to start the implementation activities. I think this is very, very good European jargon and difficult to understand. I want to make an example. a mature proposal is something which is based on something which was already active in the region, maybe a pre-existing digital innovation hub or network or something like this, which already knows how to reach out to the companies, has some experience, has maybe an office which people on, you know, puts together partners which have some experience in reading working together. A non-mature proposal is something which is completely starting from scratch, where you have a lot of good ideas, but you don't know if this will work really because you don't have past experience. So this is not a scientific explanation, but I think it explains what we have in mind. So maturity means that you need to do something which is credible, which don't forget that one of the experts will from the country, so knows probably the situation of the country, reads the proposal and says, yes, I believe that in my country this is feasible because they deal with the right public bodies, they know what is happening about these things in my country, and they have some. I hope that this helps. Yeah.
Yeah, then there is, for instance, a question on indicator number of businesses plan to use this service. If a single SME uses more than one service, it is counted as one, or is it counted for each service used? Look, I think this is something that you cannot fill in at proposal stage. You don't know if one single SME will use several services or not. So this is in the proposal phase, you just have to think about how many SMEs do you think will use this service, and whether there is one using two, that is too detailed, which you cannot predict, and that's also not what we request. So you don't have to go to such a level of detail. When you do the reporting, every year we ask you to do some reporting, then you know if one single SME has used five services. Then you can report about that. But at the proposal stage, we don't need to know that.
Then there is a question on the price list. Yes, normally, well, it's not mandatory that the SME get the services for free. I mean, the hub, correct me if I'm wrong, Anne-Marie, but the hub could charge a price for what is doing. Of course, a hub is not a commercial company and is... I mean, working because there is a market failure, what we call a market failure, because there is not enough push for digitization. So it's very likely that the hub will say, okay, I will use the funding of the European Union to offer these services for free or at a discount. But it's not mandatory that the price offered to SME is zero. And in any case, we need the price list for state aid reasons, because as will be explained in the session on state aid, there are limits for state aid. If money coming from the European Union is passed and from the national government is passed to an SME, it can state aid is more than 200,000 per year. So there are some rules. And to make sure that we are within these rules defined by the law, we need to have a price list. So even if the company has paid zero, as the service was offered for free, we know that the service, the value of the services would have been on the commercial market 50,000, and we will use this for state aid.
Indeed. So what we need in the price list is the real price. So that is maybe 2,000. Whereas you give it for zero, if you give it for free for zero, what the SME receives is 2,000 euro of support. That's so we need the difference between what the real price is and what the price is on how you offer the service. But as Sandro said, there's more about that in the session. So I would like to move to the next question of Claire. How to avoid for the EDIHs to be direct competition to SMEs that offer similar digital services? This is really a very, very important question. And it is indeed the idea that the EDIH does not replace already existing commercial services, because that would be very silly if we would subsidize already existing services that work well. So what the hub should do in those cases is that they should know who are the local providers of those services. And if there is an SME who would need that service, the hub should bring them into contact with each other and maybe hire the SME supplier as a subcontractor for the while, that he would work with that SME to test before invest, for instance. So we would see that existing suppliers, and then especially your local SME, your local ecosystem, then the one making that most stop it. Okay, so you would involve them really as subcontractors, so that your work will also be an opportunity for the local SME suppliers, the champions, as we heard this morning in the panel, Sebastiano Tovaletti made a reference to that, that they can get more customers, that the ecosystem, the local ecosystem can grow, and that we really get also good ICT suppliers in Europe. Do you next one, Sandro?
Are external human resources, e.g. external consultant, eligible in EDH application? If yes, in which budget category? I'm not 100% sure. I suppose they can be subcontractors.
Maybe we can ask that to Paloma.
Question from Marielle Campanella.
Yes, in principle, they can be included under, it can be a subcontracting on the Digital Innovation Hubs grant. It can be done like that. But we will have to see in the Moneyer grant agreement where to allocate this type of costs.
Okay, so in principle, they can be part of the hub and as a subcontractor. We don't know the details yet.
So I see a question of Kjell Bengtsson. Can you give some examples of a corridor? Will they be domain-specific, like an aerospace corridor? So we have heard this morning this notion of the corridor, which was introduced by the DIHnet. In the call for proposals, we will not use this term, corridor, but let's say today what we understand is a collaboration between different digital innovation hubs. And indeed, they can be around domains, for instance, aerospace. They can also be about sectors, so that all the digital innovation hubs who have tourism in their focus would like to work together. It can be geographical. We have heard this morning of Luxembourg, who would really like to work with Saarland, for instance, on artificial intelligence, because there they have the best AI competences in Europe. So there are different ways how you can decide that you would like to work with other European digital innovation hubs, and all these dimensions are possible. What is the proposal page limit? So that
50,
is
that's easy. 50.
Yeah, that's an easy question. It's 50 pages. And so we have now shared with you this proposal template. If you have feedback on it, we would really like to hear it. Because if you, for instance, think you cannot fit your proposal in 50 pages, that's important feedback. However, at this stage, we really think that 50 pages would be enough to describe what we want. And if you would need more, probably you will have some repetition in the proposal. But this is also something where we would really like to hear your feedback. Because that's the advantage that the call is not launched yet. We will still be able to make some changes if it makes sense.
There is also an interesting question from Jorge Molina. Some services are almost standardized, such as training of diagnosis, but of course there are the ad hoc services from the beginning, what will be needed. And those are the most important probably for a digital innovation hub. the only thing I can suggest is that this is a kind of, I mean, you can consider this as a consulting. You can estimate the number of days of consulting that you can give for companies for services which are, let's say, bespoke, which are specific for their business. I think it's the most reasonable way to consider this. Yes, we are perfectly aware that many of the services cannot be predefined now and will be defined during the lifetime of the hub. But if you consider them consulting and you evaluate them in terms of costs for the hub, then I think it's perfectly feasible.
Yes, so in the price list, you would have consulting services and that cost X amount of euros per day, for instance. And then depending on how many days a certain SME needs, you have the right price. Let me see, what is the next question? Sometimes the questions change order because people have voted them, and then the one that I had in mind, it's gone. So
there is one question from Alexandra Ricke. Member states have already made a preselection. Now, how much influence they have now? That's very simple. I think Anne-Marie this morning explaining the evaluation process. The evaluation process will be based first on a technical evaluation done by experts, which will create, you know, a candidate ranking list where they evaluate each proposal one by one. Then we will try to do the optimization in terms of guaranteeing the maximal coverage in terms of technology, geographical, sectoral coverage, and so on. And at this stage, we will consult also the member states because they can have something to say. So while it's not a process that can be reduced to an algorithm, you know, a very, very specific, like to pay taxes, you always know how to make your calculation in general. In this case, we don't know yet how to do, but certainly member states will be involved. If there are two hubs which are more or less similar, they know better than we do in Brussels which one has better routes on in the region, which one is more strategic for their digitalization strategy, and so on. So they will have a role in the evaluation.
So the next question that I see is of Mantas Vilis. It is expected that local EEN nodes will team up with the local European Digital Innovation Hub and that they will sign a memorandum of understanding to regulate their collaboration. So this memorandum of understanding does not need to be signed before the proposal. But what we do expect that is in the proposal, you would already state how you see that collaboration. And then once you are selected and the grant is starting, you could formalize this memorandum of understanding by signing it. It is important here, because these are all European Union funded activities, that we also prevent double funding of these actions and that there's a clear delineation between what will be done by the Enterprise Europe Network nodes and what will be done by the European Digital Innovation Hubs. So that is why we need this alignment. And we also think there's really a lot of added value if you work together, because the EEN, they already have very good contacts with investors and they are really already looking at helping SMEs to export to other countries. So there are things which are already very well done there. And they, on their turn, they can really benefit from your more specialized digitalization knowledge. So we see very good synergies and we really want to stimulate this. I see a question for Paloma. Can we use ongoing EFRE, so probably ERDF, and or national funded projects for co-financing the European Digital Innovation Hub?
So in principle for ERDF, no, because in order to use ERDF funding, we need to state that this is a synergy action. So that's the way in which the Digital Innovation Hubs grants and ERDF grants would be able to be combined. So for ERDF, it's not possible. For national funding, it might depend on the funding. Yes, that could not be an issue. But for the RDF, we will need to sign all that action. And if it's not the case, we won't be able to use it.
But Paloma, sorry to ask now. I thought ERDF was also signaled for synergies. Huh? It are the regional funds.
Mm-hmm.
You remember we have the discussion with DigiRegio about this?
But if the call has been signaled as synergies, yes, we could use it as it could contribute in the action. But that's the requirement, let's say.
Yeah, indeed. So some European programs, they are in synergy with each other, and that is then also stated in the work program. And Digital Europe program is one of those synergy programs. And at the moment, we are working also with DigiRegio to see how these synergies would work with ERDF, so that it could be used for co-funding also. But we still need to work out the details further.
There is an interesting question, very technical. Do you think that some member from Jorge Molina again, some members of one digital innovation hub can act as linked third parties at the stage proposal? I'm not 100% sure, but I would say, I mean, working for analogy with Horizon 2020, I would say that the answer should be yes. What is a linked third party? Linked third party is the case in which there is a long-lasting relationship between the two entities. For example, imagine a research center and a university, where the professor at the university often goes to make seminars at the research center, to work together with them, and so on. Is the research center, which is part of the hub, and the university, which is a linked third party, in the sense that provides services, possibly for free, to the partner of the hub in the context of the European Digital Innovation Hub. So I would say that the answer is yes.
You agree, yes, Paloma?
We are not going to call them linked parties anymore. I think the new terminology is affiliated entity. So you might see the difference in the wording in text or documents like the model grant agreement. But yes, in principle, it's allowed in kind contributions from affiliated entities or linked parties.
Okay, affiliated entities. Good to know.
A question of Giuseppe Franco. A specialization approach wished by the EU. Are we obliged to decide to focus on one or two key economic sectors, or can we simply refer to our regional S3? This balance between sectorial focus and the general role of a hub is not very clear to me. So here, I would like to refer to... this is a question that the Commission cannot answer. So we have seen that there are different needs in different regions, and there is no one-size-fits-all for all European Digital Innovation Hub. So what your specialization should really be what is based on the strength of the region, the needs of the industry that you want to support, what are the sectors that this local industry is working in most. So that would really be up to you to make a match which makes sense and where you can really make an added value and you can deliver the right type of support that is needed. So it would really be a choice of every European Digital Innovation Hub to see what their specialization should be. And we have just given an overall framework that it should be around artificial intelligence, HPC, and cybersecurity, because these are three key technologies that are always necessary with digital transformation. And so it can indeed be aligned with the smart specialization. Sometimes the smart specialization is also still very general, so maybe in those cases it needs to be more specific. But it would really be up to you to make something that makes sense for your community. Sandro, do you see the next question?
I see one from Chian Omorchu. I don't know if the pronunciation is anything similar to what should be. But the question is, we are a hub specializing in AI, cybersecurity, and IoT. Do we qualify as an AI hub despite also offering these other technologies? I would say this is the case for many hubs that have one main, let's say, specialization plus other things. So my answer would be yes. If the question behind this is what happens to the selection criteria, every member state there should be at least one hub specializing in artificial intelligence, then I can tell you that very likely this will not be a problem because there are so many hubs which have artificial intelligence that this requirement very likely satisfied without any problem. But again, there is no, how do you say, clear-cut answer to this. The experts will see where is the core of the activity that this hub does, and will consider that, I mean, two technologies which are related between them can be both important. Of course, if a hub presents a list of 20 different technologies, then it's not very much credible. But in this case, artificial intelligence, cybersecurity, and IoT are things which go very well together. So yes, we can consider that this is a hub specializing in artificial intelligence.
Yeah, we are almost at the end of the session, so I would like to now mention one last question of Martin Duda. Let me see. Does the EC expect that partnerships with other still potential European digital innovations will be established, confirmed at the moment of the project proposal submission, or does it expect that establishing these partnerships will be the task to be done in the first phase of the project implementation? So here, I would like to say that we would already like to see in the proposal some ideas around that. So hopefully during this event or in the time between now and the time you make your proposal, you will have the possibility to talk to other hubs on certain issues and see if it would be a win-win situation for both of you if you would form some kind of collaboration. So we would already like to see preliminary ideas about that. But this will, of course, be further developed also when all the projects are up and running and we have the Digital Transformation Accelerator, and there will be dynamic matching between needs and demand and supply and things like that. So it will also a lot happen during the project lifetime, but in the proposal, we already want to see your initial plans around that. Sander, do you want to do the last question and then we
There is a
stop?
question which I just noticed because at the bottom of the list. Does this form is usable to submit a proposal to set up a network of digital innovation hub? I don't know if I understand it correctly, but I mean there will be one network. It is the only network of European digital innovation hubs. This will be the form to present a specific proposal for one hub. All the hubs together will set up the network. We don't have sub-networks, let's put it like
Yeah,
this.
indeed. So that is very, very important to understand. Every of the 200 digital innovation hubs that we want to fund will get their own grant and they will submit their own proposal. And then there will be one support action, which is the Digital Transformation Accelerator, which will help to form the network. But you are not submitting one proposal with three hubs, for instance, that like you would do in Horizon. That is not what will be done in digital. In digital, it will really be about your own hub, how you will invest in your own hub. But of course, one of your tasks will be to network with other hubs, and therefore you also need to describe that.